Hello and welcome to the worst movie ever made, an experimental movie podcast designed with one thing in mind, to find the worst movie ever made. I'm your host, Chris Hockman, joined by my co-host and fellow mad scientist, Rob Scucci and Bob Hasek. Hey guys, how are you and why are we doing this?
I'm great because Big Brother's been playing in my household the last several weeks and Under Siege was better than that. Bob?
I bought a house since our last episode.
Yeah. And
that means in a few future episodes, I will have my own private room that is worst movie ever made headquarters.
The great thing about buying a house, I've learned, because I'm looking into it. It's going to be a couple years, but it's you pay $1,600 a month for rent, for example, and you pay it every month and you're good for it. But then the mortgage you're applying for is like $800 a month. And they're like, oh, sorry, but you can't afford that.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. It's like, fuck you. Congratulations, Bob.
Yeah, good point, Rob. That is how it is. I don't know why, but it's true.
How it is.
You got a YouTube?
I got a couple. So I don't do this often, but I have an exchange I had to read. This is a classic 90s action movie with a lot of focus on initial setting, i.e. Seagal's character is a cook but also a badass killer. This epitomizes the 90s action movie setting, so over the top yet awesome. The trailer also does a good job emphasizing this with the repetitive, I'm the cook. Next comment. It's also complete trash. Next comment, replying to that guy. Yet here you are, LOL. Next series. Thrillingly fun, pulsating action flick, a must-watch for 90s action fans. Next one, here's another exchange. This is by Icebreaker. Why can't you people make movies like this anymore? Is it the forced diversity and wokeness, or did you scare all the talented people away? By the way, Seagal here is still Seagal, but someone must point out the perfect timing of Erica Ilianek's lines. And then me replying to it on the worst movie ever made YouTube account. What do you mean by you people?
Good. That stood out to me too.
A year later. A year old comment.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Test number one, the worst of its kind.
Is this film the best of the worst or the worst of its kind?
Oh, right.
Did you guys know they made an Under Siege 2?
Yes. When I was looking up to download the file, I saw it.
Yeah. I was surprised. You know when you see the sequel that you don't expect and you're like, oh, I bet they didn't even get the same actors.
Yeah.
They got Seagal to do Under Siege number 2.
Yeah.
Oh, so, he was available, apparently. Go figure.
Yeah.
Yeah, he wasn't doing anything in Russia yet. They kept him busy, I guess.
He was between blues gigs. They didn't need a washtub player, so they brought his tub in and did Tubby fuck.
It's worse than this one. So automatically I am ruining the suspense, but it's 34%.
All right.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
so sounds about
maybe fair. Maybe a candidate for future seasons.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Universal Soldier with Van Damme and Lundgren. Have you guys seen that one? That's definitely a candidate.
Definitely. Dolph Lundgren in general is a candidate.
Yeah, I don't know why we haven't had him on yet. We love action stars that make shitty action movies, so.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We need to get him on here.
It really seems to be our bread and butter.
I think I will be choosing that for my next week's poll.
I say we all pick a shitty Lundgren movie.
Okay. Army of One, I'm picking.
All right. I like it.
I don't know that one.
It came out when I was in college. And I worked at a video store in college. And you know those big cardboard cutouts they had in the theaters?
Yeah.
We had them in the video store. They're called standees. And I had one for Dolph Lundgren called Army of One. And we didn't once we got rid of it in the store, I put it in my dorm rooms. And it was like our like signature thing.
I like it.
Never saw it though.
That's even better.
Next is Last Boy Scout with Damon Wayans and Bruce Willis. Also a bad movie.
Yeah.
Haven't seen it, but a 46% there.
Saw it. Bad.
Okay, so we have Tommy Lee Jones in this movie, Under Siege, correct?
Yeah.
Yes.
He's also in U.S. Marshals, which I feel like was a direct response to the popularity of The Fugitive.
It's exactly that.
Mm-hmm.
Is it a spinoff?
It's just the same. Like someone's missing and he's delegating loudly. And he's like in charge of finding the person that's missing.
Right.
It's what he does best, right?
Yeah.
Only a 26%. I mean, I went through and I picked some goodies here, but I thought U.S. Marshals would be one of those that brought the percentage up, but it's actually bringing the average
down. Didn't hate that movie. I mean, it's generic. I have nothing wrong with things being like derivative if it's like okay. And I thought I'd get at least a 45 or something.
Allow me to introduce an operating concept that will be a through line for this movie.
Okay.
Tommy Lee Jones makes a movie seem better than it is.
Because he's awesome. Fair. Yeah, Batman Forever. Yeah, point in case. Got it.
Yep.
Got it. 26% for U.S. Marshals.
Oh, ouch.
Yeah, real bad. And then finally, Eraser with Arnold, and that was kind of a wild card. I thought that might be good. I haven't seen it.
It's not good.
No, it's not by Rotten Tomatoes standards either at a 42%.
Okay.
So the average is a lowly 36.4%. You guys want to take a wild guess on Under Siege?
I've been trying to guess based on the YouTube comments. You know, I know like half of them are psychotic, but like it seems to be a good measuring stick for what people think of these things. And I want to say I'm going to split it right down the middle and say 50.
I don't know. It was nominated for awards. I'm going to go up in the 60s.
All right. Get a load of this, guys. Test number one is not going to operate like usual because it got a 79 on Rotten Tomatoes.
No.
So it is, not only is it not the worst of its kind, but it's a plus 42.6.
Oh, wow.
You know, in fairness, it is one of those movies where, like, you know it's shitty, but it's highly entertaining.
It is entertaining. Yeah. I'll give it that.
I mean,
but okay, don't.
At points.
Yeah.
Don't let it fool you. It's still a bad movie, at least according to us. And we're going to tell you why. As we move on to test number two, we'll give you a little summary of it in Ain't That a Pitch.
I got an idea for a movie, and here's my pitch. I get a job and quit my band, and you stop being a bitch.
Ain't that a bitch?
All right. So we're going for limericks this time, which I love. I just love the sound of one. It almost has a sea shanty kind of feel to it.
Okay.
I feel like mine's really good, so I don't want to go first.
Yeah, mine's the worst. I'll go first.
Okay.
All right. My limerick for Under Siege. A Navy SEAL chef, Steve Seagal, uses many guns, killing them all. Tommy Lee plays the blues. Gary Busey drinks booze. Miss July 89 bears it all.
Whoa. I think you're being a little too hard on yourself. That was pretty good.
That was really good. That I feel like it did what the haiku cannot, and that essentially summarized the entire movie.
I'm going to do mine. I did kind of stretch the rhyme a little bit, but I think it's necessary. And I went a little more traditional. There once was a man named Stranix who was in the need of a couple of Xanax. He dressed like a tool, played guitar like a fool, got a thumb in his eye, and then he panicked.
That was really good.
Nice.
My audio is now like doubling, though. I hope that's not on the stream and it's just me. You guys have normal audio?
Yes.
You sound fine.
Normal.
Yeah.
It's hopefully it corrects itself. Yeah, because it's weird. That was hard to like pay attention to. Because you said everything twice like you were in a baseball arena. Yeah.
All
right. Well, anyway, I'll go and hopefully it corrects itself. And if not, we'll pause or something and try to figure it out.
Yeah.
Ooh, that sounded good. You didn't repeat there.
Cool.
Good.
How about now?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I don't even know. I'm not sure if you were just fucking around.
Yes.
No, it's doubling. It's doubling up. Fuck.
All right.
Hear me now. Here goes my limerick. Gary Busey, Tommy Lee take a ship, but Seagal is aboard and he's ripped. He's real good with guns. And the way that he runs. These bad guys are in some deep shit.
I think you're the winner on this one.
Nice. Yes, I'll go with Chris.
Really? You think so?
Yeah.
Well, who do you vote for?
God, I don't know. This is way harder than the haiku one. I felt like we all did some mess already.
I feel like, because yours was entertaining, but also, like, I think Bob and I left out crucial plot points where you actually, you kind of covered the whole film.
Exactly. I think that you win no matter what, so there you go.
I guess that's true. What do you give me for a star grade, then?
3.5.
4.
3.75. Okay, that makes it easy.
Cool.
All right, let me jot that down, and hopefully this repeating nonsense clears itself up while I'm at it.
Yeah.
It's not, though. It just continues. I don't know what's up with the stream this week. It's weird.
Huh.
Oh, you know what I didn't do is jot down the hot to trot. I should have, but I didn't jot down the hot to trot. It doesn't matter because Under Siege was better for worst.
All right.
Oh, that sounded good. Okay. Let's get back to the good shit with test number 3, the worst dialogue.
This is not the greatest
dialogue. Bingo card.
This is just
some bullshit.
Throw that on the bingo card because they both say Rob Scucci on them, not the name of the file for some reason. I haven't figured that out yet. But this may roll.
Bingo card moment. Should we take a pause and I'll just rejoin and hopefully this fixes itself?
If you want to, yeah, we can do that. It's just because we're doing video now, I'm just going to keep it going. And then,
yeah, it's just like hard to everything you say is like, if you want it, just is super distracting.
Oh, yeah. Hop in.
Yeah.
All right, yeah, let me...
Good, now that he's gone. Dude, what the fuck is up Chris's ass, man? He's being such a fucking dick.
What a dick.
What a fucking asshole. I'm only recording this live on fucking Discord. I'm Chris Uncle, and I'm a stupid fucking idiot. I was hoping he'd come back, man. Hey, buddy. What's going on? We were just talking about you.
It's even worse.
Oh shit.
Oh.
What a douchebag. What a complete douchebag.
If you go to a Summer Breeze convention, Chris's face will be on the poster as biggest douche at the convention. Is Summer Breeze a brand for douches? I don't even know.
I think it's something like that, yeah.
Let's see. Douche
brand names.
Douche brands.
It's summer something or feminine, something breeze.
Feminine douches at Walgreens. Let's see what we got here. Let's see. Summer's Eve. Yeah, Summer's Eve. Summer breeze. They rhyme. Yeah.
So Summer's Eve. That's right. Yeah. That's right. That's right. That's the one.
Good clean love. Balanced moisturizing wash. 8 fluid ounces. $11. That's how many servings is that? What's the macros on that?
Tablespoons to cups ratio on that?
If you eat a whole tube, are you going to get gains or are you just going to get diarrhea?
Is that what you do? You eat them?
Yeah. You eat them.
You squeeze the tube into your mouth and just, you know, swallow whole and you end up with freshness down below.
PhD, boric acid vaginal suppositories. All right. Single listeners, if you're on a date and a girl says she's got a PhD. Double check to make sure what the source of that PhD is.
Oh no, here he comes.
How's the sound?
Much better.
Oh, cool. So we left it recording and we were we were reading nutrition facts for douches, basically.
Oh.
Okay.
Nutrition facts?
Wait till you hear this.
Yeah. You'll hear it later. It's cool.
Okay, cool. All right. Test number 3, the worst dialogue. By the way, I think my neighbors are having a party again. They did last night, and that was super fun. all right, let's do this thing.
All right.
Number 10. Just throwing this out there. It's not necessarily dialogue. Tommy Lee right. Jones, his band and his name as the lead singer of his little group, Bad Billy and the Bail Jumpers. How'd you guys like that?
Yeah, bad news on that front.
That's not the kind of band that would get booked on like the USS Missouri. But like, if they were like playing in some podunk town, I'd believe it.
Right.
They're playing at the Beachcomber right now, I think. Yeah. Even though it's been demolished.
The Comber.
It was an awesome dive bar in Milford.
Bob, in 2010, you could smoke inside at the Beachcomber.
The Beachcomber is an efficiency hotel in Stone Harbor, New Jersey.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I'm sure that many, many establishments exist.
Right. Yeah. But yeah, smoking indoors in 2010, that is pretty funny.
Yeah.
Yes, true. Okay. Number 9. This is Lieutenant Taylor. If you guys don't remember, he was the red-haired guy who was giving Steven Seagal's character, Ryback, a lot of shit in the beginning of the movie.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Lieutenant Taylor says to him, Ryback, we still have a week together. And then, almost incoherently, as if he was drunk, Seagal says back, I guess that means I want to get to see you go through puberty. And everybody laughs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The reason I say it's incoherent is because he's like, Ryback is saying we still have a long time together. So Seagal's like improv joke there actually doesn't work with the concept of time that Taylor is, you know, oh, well, I guess we won't have time to see you go through puberty is kind of a, I don't know, not a parallel. It's perpendicular.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Number 8, sub-captain. The guy who was the captain of the sub who was Russian or something. He says, in the sign of Wile E. Coyote? And Stranek says, negative. Meet at the birdcage as planned. Roadrunner out. Krill says, that's Gary Busey. You're the Roadrunner? And Stranek says, yeah, never been caught. Beep, beep. I mean, I don't hate it, but I felt like it was it's one of those lines where, you know, they're like, their intention is to make you really like Tommy Lee real quick, or at least make you think that he's clever. And I don't think it hit very.
He would be good in like a joke, like an old, with his age now, if they made it like a Joker movie, like elderly Joker.
Oh yeah,
he could do like that happy go lucky psychotic asshole pretty well.
It was all about trying to hit the demographic, and that's what makes me so upset, because in 92, is that when this came out? 91, 92?
I don't know.
I was like just entering or just like in the early years of high school, and the Looney Tunes, which is what Roadrunner and Wile E. Coyote were referencing, were huge in my youth, and they were trying to hit that demographic. And I think I feel like that's all it was it was pandering, and I hate pandering.
Yeah,
very acute point there, and heard. You're heard, Bob. Number 7 is our first clip. This one's called Cooking Knives.
Yeah.
Okay, you're coming with me. You gotta be invisible. If you walk by a hatch and you see the enemy, you become the hatch. I'm gonna give you this assault rifle. It's an MP5. There's a selector switch on it. One is fully automatic, one is semi-automatic. The definition of semi-automatic is for when you depress the trigger, one round will go off. That's what I wanna give you. I want you to spend one round at a time, okay?
Turn on the lights.
Check the breaker box. It's happened before, it's no big deal.
Man who did this is a professional. Who is he? And what's he doing running around loose on my battleship, Mr. Krill?
Your battleship? You wouldn't be on this battleship if it wasn't for me. He's a cook, plain and simple.
This is not the work of a cook.
He came on board with the captain. I know his routine, front and back. He's good with cooking knives.
Cooking knives!
I'm just going to say what I feel about this movie right now. I this might be a catch-all thing, but I want you guys to have it in your heads. Steven Seagal has this, like, fuck, he's good complex. And every movie he's in, where it's like, it's like, this guy's a professional. This guy's more than he's leading on. And then It's Eric Cartman when he's pretending to be Brad Pitt. And his kids are like, Daddy, is it bigger than a bread box? What does that mean? Daddy, you're so funny and cute. Like, everything he does is awesome. And he has no fault. And it's just not a real person. It's not a real... It's a fiction. It's a fiction 101 writer writing a story, but they're all about... The story's about themselves, and they don't know how to have a flawed character because they're writing about themselves.
Right.
And I've peer-reviewed hundreds of those fucking stories where it's just like, yeah, it's like, dude, you need some depth in your characters. You're not that awesome all the time. You're a person. It's fucking stupid. Right.
Obviously, it's annoying when they are.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's why this movie's bad and everyone else thinks it's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess because they want to believe that that's possible because that's what they believe about themselves.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Number six, some henchman says, Mother Goose, the quails are in the nest.
Yeah.
I think that meant the, like, the Navy guys were in a trap at that point or something. Just a little bit. I liked it being right after the Roadrunner thing because it they're going for the analogy language a little hard.
Yeah.
Number five. The doctor at the very end. So you remember at the end of the movie, Seagal's got one slash on his face because Tommy Lee Jones was so good as CIA officer and combatant that he was able to slash Seagal once.
Yeah.
He's like, you're going to need three or four stitches. I'd like to see you down in the infirmary. Ryback says back, yeah, I'm afraid of needles. The entire crowd goes,
Yeah, because every joke has to kill, right?
Right.
Right. What is the joke? I'm afraid of needles?
He finally has an audience. Exactly.
Yeah.
Because he was unafraid to go into trouble. It's really funny that, like, he would run into gunfire, but he's afraid of needles. Is that the joke?
Yeah,
that's
I think so.
Exactly, yes. That's a joke.
I wasn't sure because that's not funny. That's just a shitty joke.
No, it's a shitty joke.
Really bad.
All right, number four, Stranix says, that's Tommy Lee Jones. What are you going to do when you have $200 million in the bank? Krill, Gary Busey says back, buy the presidency. Does that mean he's gonna get some like talking like some avatar and put him in the presidency to do as Busey sees fit, or does that mean that he's going to buy his way into the presidency? Because that means that's something you can do, which I don't think is true.
The second thing, and yes, I do think it's true.
All right. Yeah. That's fair. I was gonna continue by saying, in a sense, it's true. If you spend enough money on advertising your campaign and blah blah blah, get enough lobbyists on your side, and you know people to fight for you. Sure, if you have $1 trillion, but look at Bloomberg, right?
Yeah,
And he had a fuck ton of money, and he's not president,
right?
More than Trump, probably. All right, here's another clip. This is the second of the day. We're going straight clips till the end here because I can't do as well as these guys can do expressing how bad they are delivering this shitty dialogue. Here's a clip called Swimming.
Hey, great job!
Want to go swimming? I got a Zodiac here and some sea rays, you know, a little umbrella.
You did it, Case.
I'll go with you.
Yeah.
What's a Zodiac?
I don't know.
Stingrays, a little umbrella. I get those. A little umbrella and like a drink, but
yeah.
What's a Zodiac? A watch that you wear on the beach?
Yeah.
I know none of those things.
I literally didn't understand that at all. So maybe it's not funny. But I didn't understand it at all, and this is the worst dialogue. So you can't write things that the listener cannot understand.
Yeah,
exactly.
Okay, speaking of which, here's our next clip. This one's called, huh?
Great history.
Y'all never hear about the joke when Andre and Boudreaux went hunting down on a bayou? Where the guns? Where the guns, Juliet?
That's about right.
And in the end,
what? Were we supposed to understand that too?
I wrote down Hnghnughnugh on the bayou.
I feel like the best part of that is that the extras, like actors, the ancillary characters there laughed before there was a punchline.
Yeah.
Because they didn't know when it was coming. He's like, hey, you ever hear about Don't See an Island in the Bayou? And they're like, ha, 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 ha. And he's like, no, give him, slap the bear. And
exactly. They deserve best supporting actor nominations for this one.
I agree. All right. Well, speaking of not making sense, I guess that's the theme of the worst dialogue. Let's throw it to a drum roll.
All right.
Mustache Chicken.
Yes.
Direct hit!
All right.
We hit it!
Yeah!
Way to go!
Way to go!
Yay!
Stranis, what the hell's going on?
Porky Pig, little red fucker with a mustache. One of the big chickens.
Strenix. All of my life. Saturday morning cartoons. The best. Oh, shit. Whoa.
For example, do you remember those two little shrimp coming in, riding in on those two little seahorses with little hats, little chaps, little pistols? Bam, bam, bam! Shooting back over their shoulders. Rescue that lobster from the Swedish cook.
Funniest thing you ever saw in my life? Splendid work, by the way.
And it's splendid work. My, my, my. How hell doth quicken the spirit.
He's wrong. They're called horsefishes. We established that.
Yeah, we just established it.
We know better.
Well said. I think that that was kind of like a Rico moment from last week where they're supposed to, like, we're supposed to think he's gone mad now, right?
Yeah.
But just talking about Saturday morning cartoons doesn't do that. But for me, anyway, I just felt like he was having a, a panic attack or something like that. I was trying to bring himself back to like a happy memory. And it was poorly written because he's like, the little red fucker with a mustache and a chicken. And
right.
I don't know. I just could. I hated it.
Yeah. Well, to your point, he made an apt analogy. It's just one that no one cares about.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Test number four, the worst production.
No!
The worst production.
The worst production. When you're calling to work.
The worst production.
The worst
production.
Make my statement go berserk.
The worst production. Okay, so the worst production this week. This is Under Siege, Steven Seagal. So the movie. This movie, Under Siege, suffered from too many cooks in the kitchen. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Say no more.
Forget.
So Seagal was, as so many action stars seem to be, allowed to exercise his creative muscles in the script. Now, we talked about this last week with Stallone.
True.
He was actually allowed to exercise his creative muscles in script, storyboard, and directing. So he suggested things, rewrote things, redirected things. Overall, just put his hands in things he wasn't qualified to put his hands into. The movie isn't great, but it would have probably been better had it not been taking advice from Steven Seagal, a man who relies on his ponytail, but this movie he was ponytailless.
Yeah, true.
And he's an actor. He is not the director, the producer, the writer. That's the worst production. The worst production is an actor, and by the way, this is fact, had too much influence in the story and the script and the directing.
Yeah.
I was actually surprised that he was okay with Tommy Lee Jones getting so much dialogue.
Yeah.
Right. I want to say Seagal actually only had 40 minutes of screen time in an hour and 40-minute movie.
Yeah.
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 Which was surprising. It was kind of like, what was that movie we watched? Man, the one, did we do this as a pod where Seagal is with the SEAL team going in to save the president or something like that? Fuck, what was that? We definitely did this on a pod. And Seagal just dies out of nowhere.
We did not do that. I didn't do that one.
Seagal, okay, I must have been talking with another friend about this movie, but Seagal is like billed as like the fifth name on the movie, and I fucking wish I knew what this was. I feel like it was maybe, I don't know. I felt like it was relatively recent. Anyway, I digress. He dies way before you would expect it. It's like, wow, I can't believe that Seagal would ever okay that. But I think maybe at that point in his career, he had lost some of his steam, so he was just happy to be involved.
Executive decision?
No, I don't think that's it. I have no idea. Yeah. Well, anyway, Bob, so too many cooks in the kitchen. Basically, it's really too large a cook in a small kitchen or something.
I'm okay with that. Yeah, I like the way you wrote that.
Because unless you mean to say that also Tommy Lee Jones or
they were just acting. They did their jobs. Yeah. It was Seagal that was he literally influenced the production, the writing, the directing, the scene. What do they call that? The storyboards. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, I feel like Van Damme did that a lot too.
Yeah,
he did, and so did Stallone.
Yeah, for sure. I guess anybody with real influence.
Yeah,
then just gets too big for their britches.
And that's where this one suffered, because it could have been, dare I say, better.
Mm.
Yeah,
had he not flexed his muscles, or should I say flexed his pseudo muscles.
Yeah,
seriously, we're gonna talk more about that too. But not until we get to Rob's ad read for the week.
Oh, this is a good one. Today's episode of The Worst Movie Ever Made is brought to you by algorithmic censorship, because banning somebody on Instagram who called somebody who said the N-word a potato is somehow against community guidelines. The N-word comment is still up, though. Ain't that peculiar? So anyhow, when we do the live stream after tonight's recording, I'll be using a different username, because calling somebody a potato, telling somebody to go ride a roller coaster, and calling somebody you just met a fucking cunt who you hope gets AIDS is apparently out of line. Thanks, Metaverse.
I feel like I have a piece of algorithmic knowledge in my head.
Okay.
That just came to me.
What's that?
All right. Allow me to say this without too much of a punishment, I hope, audience. Sure. When you use the N-word, you're one of probably, I don't know how many millions of people.
Yeah.
When you call somebody a potato, you're probably going to get a fat shaming minority group coming out. I never
thought of that. And then when you tell someone that they're a cunt and you hope they get AIDS, you probably shouldn't say that either.
Yeah, they probably have the cunt and AIDS words as immediate signifiers for hate speech.
I guarantee the potato N-word thing. The potato thing makes perfect sense. I never thought of that.
Yeah.
That's my go-to insult.
It's a good one. Yeah. But it's probably some fat activist, minority group, throwing their weight at that Instagram.
I wonder.
Potatoes.
All right, test number five, the most offensive.
Sure. Good segue.
Don't call me faggot, you!
Eric, did you just say the F word?
You? No, he's talking about
Yeah.
All right. I'm not going to pretend like just because I work in a professional kitchen, every kitchen thing that ever happens is of special concern to me. But I do find it to be a little offensive that you have a knife throwing bullseye in a professional kitchen.
Yeah, not good.
I mean, when we're walking around, like, everyone is very cognizant of where the knives are.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, if you have a knife in your hand, you need to, like, loudly alert everyone in the kitchen that you're walking with a knife. Yeah. Because you don't want someone to turn around into it, and then you murdered them.
Behind sharp, behind hot, corner, corner. Sharp, you know?
Yeah.
Am I going to fill a bingo card if I say something about the giant chef's hat?
No! Oh. I'm just kidding. No, please.
That just made me laugh that he was the head chef and he had a giant fucking chef's hat.
Yeah.
He did have a big chef's hat.
Yeah.
Not for long, though.
Yeah.
No.
And maybe he tried it out and, like, he decided it didn't look good or something like that. No one could ever tell him it didn't, though, you know?
Yeah.
Have you worn one before, Chris?
I've never worn a chef's hat.
No one wears a chef's hat.
Exactly. Yeah. That's why I thought it was funny.
You wear a hairnet or a baseball cap. That's it.
You wear right. a baseball cap.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. Yeah.
I wear a backwards hat every day.
Yeah.
Because I don't like the way the rim shapes my head, if I'm honest. Exactly. I'm not an anti-forward facing baseball cap guy. I'm not a young punk who wears a backwards hat because he thinks it looks young and cool. Yeah. It's because if I wear the rim forward, I look like a douche.
Yeah. I'm the same way. I can't wear it backwards for the same reason. It's
same. All right, same.
Sunglasses too. It's sunny out and there's a white sidewalk and I'll put sunglasses. I'll be like, what kind of fucking douche do I think I am wearing sunglasses right now? I don't know. It's like a weird thing.
No, if I wear it forward, I look like I think I'm a cop. Or something, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I just can't do that. All right. Every man aboard is uncomfortably joyful around Miss July.
Yeah.
It's a little gross. I mean, we kind of did this with Suicide Squad way back. But when Harley Quinn is changing, every, like, military man at the base is, like, staring at her. The effect is supposed to be everybody look at how hot this chick is.
Yeah.
But in reality, like, it plays super uncomfortable. And, you know, I've heard about the Navy that more than one in five men are of a different personality.
Swabbing the poop deck. Is that
what you're saying? Oh, boy.
That's what I've heard. I mean, you know, that has not been confirmed as fact.
In the Navy.
Number three. Oh, how hilarious Gary Busey is cross-dressing, huh, guys? Really funny.
Yeah.
Super, super funny that he's dressed like a woman.
Hysterical.
Yeah, and then he does the, like, half-lady voice because he didn't want to commit to it. And
yeah.
Just was a total, like, wet fart joke. It just sucked. Actually, wet fart joke might have been funnier.
Probably.
Maybe.
Speaking of which, Gary Busey, anyway, Krill, who is Gary Busey, says, why can't you speak English? Some guy, like, working on the side of the boat.
Yeah, right.
I was like, holy shit.
That's what
Karen say. You know?
I knew that was coming, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I could believe it when he said that. I guess I could. It's Gary Busey 1, and it's Commander Krill 2.
Yeah.
It's 1992, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. We have more coming that I felt like was 80s and below, but showed up in a 90s movie. I feel like Steven Seagal going hand-to-hand combat with guys wasn't necessarily, needed. I almost said necessarily necessary, but, like, he's got guns and stuff, but then you find him... Yeah. Fist fighting guys because he needs to show his karate prowess, but you didn't have to pull the guy's throat out.
Yeah,
no, exactly.
I couldn't believe that. It was like Temple of Doom all of a sudden.
Yeah. Where
he, like, fucking rips the guy's throat out. And he's like, you know, I felt like Jim Carrey in Dumb and Dumber.
Yeah, it was like Kano from Mortal Kombat ripping the heart out. Yeah, mm-hmm.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
That was almost shocking. All right, a couple more. They said, I'm just going to read it as I wrote it instead of ruining it. leaving Miss July in the cake for, I don't know, 14 hours or so.
Because she was drugged.
Yeah, but
she was drugged unconscious in a cake.
So they gave her a bunch of sleepy time pills, so she didn't wake up until showtime, and then forgot, everyone on the ship forgot that Mr. Lai was in there.
Yeah.
And then she wakes up and then, like, just does the thing. Like, oh, shit, I must be late to perform. And keeps her eyes closed and isn't wondering why there's no sound around her. She just gets up and does it's totally bonkers, dude. It's completely wrong. Everything about it.
It's crazy. Yeah. That's why I made the trailer.
Yeah, well, if you want to see two boobs in there, and one Bob butt, take a look at our trailer. It's not real boobs. It's just Rob and I. It's really funny, though. Really funny trailer.
Which is really two boobs, actually.
Yeah, we are two boobs.
Yeah, we are. It's true. All right, let's hit another clip this time for Most Offensive. Unusual, but it's called They Went There.
Good one.
Throwing in a brig. Knock him out. Throwing in a brig. Nobody goes to the brig without the old man's signature.
Good point. Secure him in the meat locker.
Now.
Right now.
Let's go.
Now I know why you're a cook. Shit like a faggot. Steel. Private Nash, you came on aboard in Hawaii?
Yes, sir.
Then you don't know about Chief Ryback. He is an extreme psychopath. He hates officers. He hates America. This is the captain's birthday. I do not want him ruining it. No one is to speak to him. No one is to let him out. If he tries to escape, shoot him right here. I'm counting on you.
Yes, sir.
Let's go.
Fun fact, he wanted to say he hits like a potato, but they wanted to keep it rated R, so they had to dial it back a little bit.
I cannot believe that Gary Busey said that word. He said, I'm going to say it out loud, he said Hawaii.
Yeah.
Yes, he did.
He pronounced it like he's native to the state.
Yeah.
Obviously, I'm joking. He said something else that was way more offensive than that.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say it, though. We're just going to move straight on to test number 6, the worst acting.
The quality of an actor's work on screen might be a matter of opinion most of the time, but there are some performances so awful that all subjectivity goes out the window.
Yeah. All right, let's get into one. Oh, let's get into bingo card. Hit it. Our first clip of the worst acting. This one happened a minute and a half into the movie, and it's aptly titled Whites. I'll explain why later.
I always love these because you sent me the timestamps. I'm like, oh, you know this movie sucks when like you're not even past the vanity, like the fading vanity clips of the credits.
Yeah, minute and a half
down.
Hey, Case.
Hey, Tuck, how you doing?
What's happening? Hey, where's your whites? The press is coming.
You won't miss me. What is this, huh? You're in the Navy, man. You gotta look good, huh?
There we go.
Cuba, what's up?
Ryback, where's your whites?
Poor boy doesn't have a dress uniform.
I got the dress. I forgot the pump.
I feel like he went slightly into that Seagal, like when he's addressing a white person, he speaks like a white man. Yeah. And when he addresses a black person, he sounds like he's from the bayou all of a sudden.
Yeah.
Yes. Which is why I felt like Whites was the perfect title for that one. All right. Correct. Here comes another clip for the worst acting. This one's called Good Guy.
Here we go.
How do we know he's not working for him? Hey, I'll guarantee Chief Ryback. He's a good guy.
Now, wait a minute. We're not going to take the chance. Don't tell him anything about our response.
Chief Ryback, Captain Garza.
Glad you're there, Captain.
What we want you to do at this point is just continue to feed us on-site intel.
Nick, this man may be crazy, but he's a professional. I mean, they're manufacturing some kind of a railing system to offload the Tomahawks. And believe it or not, the Exo's in with them.
Commander Krill's involved? Admiral, That means they control the ship.
Holy God.
Chief Ryback, this is Admiral Bates speaking.
Sir.
I want you to coordinate your efforts with us. You understand that? And I want you to keep cool and wait for the strike team. Do you understand that?
Yes, sir. I better get off, sir, before they pick up the signal.
Get back to us in half an hour.
Roger that.
You're not a cook.
Yeah, well, I also cook. Get your stuff.
Fuck, he's good.
So good.
Did we lose Chris?
Uh-oh. There he is.
Oh, Mr. Portrait.
We are having connectivity issues tonight. Ooh.
Yeah. I don't know if you heard my, after that clip, I said, fuck, he's good. He's so good.
Well, he is good. Honestly, the whole reason for the clip was the first, like, government official in the council who's like, I guarantee Ryback is one of our good guys. Yeah. Like, the delivery for that line was so bad. I was surprised. I had to capture that for sure.
Yeah.
Unless there's anything else, we're going to move right into our next clip called Guitar.
Yeah. Home run.
Yeah.
We did it. Miss Little Piggy went to market. Miss Little Piggy stayed home. And Miss Little Piggy. Oh, mama. Oh, mama. Wee, 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 wee. All the way home. Happy trails.
All right, now meet us. In the captain's launch, there's the MX-2020, the sealed megaphone. You get that and bring it to me and take her with you.
The what?
Okay, the car phone.
Car phone.
Car phone.
Fuck, he's good.
Oh, yeah. The old bring back from earlier in the movie. But yeah, there's no way to do that Tommy Lee thing right, I don't think.
Yeah.
Like, they probably took 10 takes and every one of them was just weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, it has to be. Just a really odd scenario to put your one of your best actors in the movie in.
They're like 37 takes in. He's like, no, I think it's an E flat minor, and I think I went to F sharp.
Imagination. No, I think it went imagination.
South Park.
Bingo.
Let's throw it to fact or no fact.
The worst movie ever made presents fact or no fact.
All right, I called this one Blunder Siege.
I like it.
You are good.
I'm good at wordplay. Not as good as Rob. Rob's much better than I am. Anyway, we're looking for finding the fact out of five things that could be facts, but only one of them actually is one. Okay, so this is about the movie Under Siege. So Seagal is the first fact, by the way, that could be or could not be a fact. Seagal wanted a sex scene with Erica Eleniak, and she refused. Barely submitting to a kiss at the end. That's the first one. Second one, Tommy Lee Jones had to wear a wig due to the short haircut he was forced to wear for The Fugitive, which he filmed nearly at the same time as this movie. Okay, third one, Gary Busey's character was supposed to be court-martialed, not killed, but he was so difficult to work with. The filmmakers killed his character off in the submarine scene instead. Fourth one. A celebration scene at the end of the movie was filmed with Seagal playing guitar, but was cut from the final movie. And the last one, the tape, like the VHS tape. I don't know if you guys know VHS tapes.
Yeah.
The VHS tape of the movie that was rented was so worn out because people kept rewinding and playing and rewinding and playing the nude scene so frequently. Okay, so
you'd be compared to other tapes.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, like it was and ruined.
You said you worked at a video store. Yeah,
I did work at a video store, but that was in the late 90s, not the early 90s. Anyway, Seagal wanted a sex scene. Tommy Lee Jones had to wear a wig. Gary Busey's character was so hard to work with. A celebration scene with Seagal playing guitar. Or the VHS tape was ruined.
Huh. Okay. The wig one's believable for Tommy Lee Jones because, I mean, that shit happens. With all the Stranger Things kids, they had, like, really good hair pieces because they were doing other shit. I don't believe the Busey one because, like, even before, like, his accident and, like, his weird transformation, I heard he's just been like a kind of like likable eccentric weirdo who's like, I don't know if that means he's hard to work with or not, but I think he's like overall like kind of approachable. So I'm going to rule that one out. I don't think Steven Seagal got into guitar until like later. So I'm going to get rid of that one. I want to say like that was like a 2000s and up thing. I don't think he played his whole life, but I could be wrong. Sex scene. See, I think they wanted a sex scene, but they wanted to keep it rated R. I think that's one of your little famous Bobo misdirects where she didn't refuse it. I think it was a rating thing. I think that's what happened. So the VHS, I don't think that would be notable because there's you have Die Hard. There's boobies and stuff in other movies, and this wouldn't be the exception because there is so little screen time of the boobs. So I would say there's other movies that are contemporary to Under Siege that would have seen equal rewind wear that would have been notable. So I don't think so. Tommy Lee Jones, I think that's the fact. He's wearing
a wig. You're going with the
wig. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I'm sure that I'm sure that Seagal wanted a sex scene, probably, but I feel like it is probably not thrown out because of her refusal necessarily, but it just doesn't fit the narrative of the movie. Like, they're not going to stop while Navy men are drowning to bang out a quickie
in the meat locker. Yeah,
right. Jones and the wig, boy, that one's good. I don't know how to know. This is more Bob Foolery because I don't know how long exactly there is between, if there's 3 months, that's enough time. Maybe. I don't know how fast his fucking hair grows. How am I supposed to know that? You know, some people have been growing faster than others. I don't know. Busey court-martialed. I mean, they were going to film that. That would have been a whole, I just don't believe that they would have a whole like court case at the end of the movie tied in or whatever. And the VHS tapes, yeah, Rob, I agree. It wouldn't be notable that it was worn out if that was something that could happen to tapes, which I'm sure it could, but on average, I think guys would be afraid that their wives would come down for a glass of milk in the middle of the night and see that they were finding the fucking tape. You know, like a lot of dudes aren't doing that. Nice pair of mammalian protuberances as they were, probably not happening. So I'm going to go with the celebration scene because I think Seagal's been playing guitar forever.
All right. My favorite part of every episode is listening to you guys go through these. So the celebration scene was purely put on because you guys sent me texts about Seagal's guitar collection.
Damn it.
He owned that guitar before Jimi Hendrix was Jimi Hendrix, you know.
I thought he cared more about playing guitar than he did having sex with Mr. Lai.
Probably. I knew nothing about Seagal's guitar collection until you guys started sending me texts. So yeah, that is totally. I added that little. I couldn't think of a fifth lie.
God damn it.
I couldn't think of a fourth lie until I got those texts. I'm like, I got it. I got the lie.
Now I'm feeling like what was he going to do at the end? Be like, somebody pass me a guitar. I'm going to play a song.
He's crowdsourcing.
Obviously, that wasn't the thing. But...
Okay. So the sex scene thing was a lie. I'm going to lead you into wearing a wig. I totally made that up.
Okay.
I totally... Gary Busey's character, I made that up because Busey is a weirdo. And the actual fact is that the tapes, the VHS tapes of the movie were worn out and had to be, like, trash or replaced because people kept rewinding and fast-forwarding. Right?
You successfully threw me off the scent by saying that you're at, a video store in the late 90s.
Yeah.
Well, I was like, wait a minute. Maybe he had insider information.
And this is all fact because I did work in a video store in 96, 97, 98. But Under Siege was not in my – but I read this in online that this was actually a fact, that those videotapes were being – like if you ever watched a videotape on VHS, if there's something that's worn or overplayed or something, you will see a bit of an issue during that
tracking
scene.
Issues, yeah.
You'll have some tracking issues.
It makes sense.
And that's all it really was. It wasn't a major issue, but it was still something that was – noticeable, like as soon as she got nude, you see the tape jump up and down, which people got upset with. So they had to make more copies. That's a fact. Damn. That's a fact. That's not a no fact.
Wow.
She was in Baywatch, right?
Yeah,
she was. Original season, yes.
Yeah, she she has a nice figure, so I'm not all this bro.
She has breasts that look like you two. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
I know. Yeah, well, that's what's so nice about them.
Why wouldn't you watch?
I'm the left titty.
Yeah, and my nose looks just like a nipple, so it's perfect. Let's throw it to the catch-all.
We're only asking you to pick up what we're throwing down because you're not catching it in the first place. Welcome to the catch-all.
I'm fucking cooking, goddammit. I'm not going up to watch the ceremony. I'm fucking cooking, no matter what you do.
You know what? That's very accurate for a line cook, though. Like, the restaurant I worked at before COVID, like, there were Super Bowls and halftime shows and no orders coming in the kitchen, but, like, I knew we were behind on prep. I'm like, nope, I'm not gonna look at it for a minute because, like, I'm gonna be fucked over somehow if I don't.
Yeah, I guess that's true. They're not being, like, subpoenaed to the...
No, you're not being subpoenaed, but there's a whole like if I take a 15-minute break now, I'm not getting out till 2 a.m. And it's one of those things. So I could see that.
Yeah, but they were gonna be replaced completely. They weren't gonna have to come back and catch up. They were gonna just not have to cook at all. I'm like, I'm gonna go celebrate. Fuck that. I'm not
I'd go celebrate. Yeah, they're bringing in food from Hawaii.
Hawaii. Speaking of Busey, him hawking a loogie is incredibly funny.
Yes.
Oh, gross. So gross.
Hey, Seagal has a nice, Ryback has a nice minestrone going or something.
Yeah.
And Busey's like,
it was bouillabaisse or bouillabaisse.
Oh, yeah, it was the bouillabaisse. Yeah, right.
Yeah, it was gross.
Good call. Okay, so here's a trope for you when Tommy Lee Jones is speaking to all of the Navy men and he's like, now move out of here in an orderly fashion. Nobody moves, right? And then he goes, now! And everybody's like all of a sudden startled and they all run off.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a movie thing that doesn't happen in real life.
Yeah.
Bad guys scaling the ship with like rope for literally no reason.
Yeah.
Right.
They probably had other points of entry that were way easier than that.
Oh, yeah.
Right. I mean, exactly.
The guys that took over the ship were the ones who came up behind them from like below deck with guns.
Yeah.
Not the guys that were scaling from the top that got their how by going through the entire ship and climbing to the top of the ship so that they can scale down it. Unless there was a fucking military helicopter that dropped them off too. And then they would have known about it. It was just totally ridiculous.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed the evil roast beef slinging.
Yep.
Where could Ryback be? He's not in the freezer. Oh, wait. He's above us in the vent thing.
Yeah.
Right.
It's a trope. Does a small knife to the throat cause immediate death?
Yeah, I mean, if you're as good, like, if you're like, fuck, he's good as Seagal, then yeah.
I feel like you have to bleed out over the course of some time.
He knows the kill shot, man. He's just like, oh,
my God.
Have you seen, what was that movie? I'm trying to get the name of it now. I can't think of it now.
Bad Santa.
No, it's Hot Fuzz.
Hot Fuzz, yeah, oh. I have not. I've seen.
No, I also have not.
Hot Fuzz, Timothy Dalton, who used to be a James Bond,
yep.
It meets his at least, not demise, but his end with a spike through his chin up through his mouth. So it's not quite an esophagus pierce, but it's something very similar, and it does not kill him.
Okay, through there.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
All right.
Okay, yeah, that wouldn't kill you. Probably. At least not immediately.
So maybe it's something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. How about punching a guy into some ropes where he dangles to death?
Yeah.
He dangles to death. That's funny.
Seriously, Seagal is like just walking up some stairs. This guy like comes out and he punches him and he falls into some ropes and hangs upside down and he's dead.
Yeah.
He's done.
From literally a punch. Yeah. Send two men to kill the one man that could jeopardize the entire mission, while the rest of us eat meat and drink champagne.
I was about to say, I know they're like Navy men and like they're used to like the sea legs and like motion sickness and stuff, but like they were drinking a lot to be on like a boat that they knew was going to be probably experiencing some sort of turbulence.
That's fair. We did not see any ill effects of motion on the ocean. Now that you mentioned.
Yeah.
No, none.
Yeah, that's a really good point.
Mm-hmm.
Gotta say, the Jimi Hendrix was nice.
It was a good touch.
Yeah.
Yeah. Enjoyed it. Here's a trope. Wronged special operative goes revenge rogue.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm thinking Ed Harris in The Rock immediately.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
The file on Ryback is comical. I think he has two purple hearts.
He's so good. That's why I mentioned it early. Like, he's like, he can do no wrong. The only thing he did wrong was punch like a commanding officer who was like apparently being a douche.
Right. Who ended up being evil. Yeah.
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 Now Miss July is a badass. And by that, I mean she like knows how to load a strange gun.
Yeah.
When the Navy guy who doesn't like to be in combat doesn't know how to do it.
Yeah.
Just because exactly. She's been in a gunfight where she hid behind Steven Seagal.
Yeah, exactly.
Couldn't the bad guys just turn the drowning Navy men water valve back on? I mean, a guy died to turn that valve.
Yeah.
And they could just like walk back over and turn it back on. They didn't like rip it off with like a wrench or anything. Like,
yeah,
exactly.
They fought to turn the water off. With a valve that can just easily be turned the other way again.
To that point, the Navy crew was in like a flooding, you know, enclosure, and you find out that's happening to them, and it shows it happening to them, and they like forgot until like the last 5 minutes of the movie, like, oh shit, we had to like tie up that little story too.
Yeah,
they let them all.
That's probably why. Yeah.
Because I was writing down, I was like jotting notes on my phone, and I was like. Did they ever address this? And then it finally happened, like, before the credits rolled.
Yeah. It was really funny that they never showed them even, like, partially submerged.
Yeah.
And then when they are freed, they're, like, celebrating as they're coming, like pouring out of the doors.
Yeah.
And so, like, they're definitely clanking their bodies into metal, and it's super painful. But they're like, yeah!
Ridiculous.
That was funny too. Now that you mention it, I think I sent you guys a screenshot, but the crossover two-hander Uzi fire.
Oh, by Seagal,
as if that's accurate at all.
right. So I don't know about guns, but how is that more efficient than like?
It's not.
It's like I understand like drumming cross-handed because of your dominant hands, like keeping the rhythm.
Yeah.
But like most people do that. But like with guns, it's like, no, like your dominant hand should point in the dominant direction. Should it not?
Yes.
Like, yeah.
Yeah. It
your,
makes
your
sense.
Your hand should extend from where your shoulders begin.
Yeah.
With guns. So, yeah.
Yeah. And the, what do you call that? The kickback would be way too much.
Yeah,
otherwise.
Going,
oh yeah. Yeah, for yeah. sure. But he can adjust for all that though. We're forgetting.
That's true. Exactly. He's to go.
Do all Navy SEALs know how to disarm nuclear weapons?
No.
Sure.
They did have some cool props. Like the missiles did look like missiles.
Yeah.
You know?
I guess so.
Does Ryback keep the scuba gear with his knife set, you think?
Yeah.
I guess.
Where the fuck did he get like a full scuba suit?
Who
the fuck knows? Was it under the chef's hat the whole time?
He wouldn't even be fitted for it because he's staffed as a cook.
Right. And he's 6'5".
In any other like practical scenario where they're not being under siege, sorry for the title drop, he would not need a scuba suit, so therefore there would not be a scuba suit.
Right.
There's no scuba suit.
Yeah.
Doesn't happen.
Exactly correct, yes.
Another trope, this is a very Judge Dredgy trope, but when Gary Busey, that is Kirill, is about to fire on a helpless Ryback, Mr. Lai shoots him in the back.
Yeah.
Yep.
I'm surprised that Seagal allowed that to happen. That means he was in a compromised position where he would have lost.
Yeah. True.
Yep.
Did the evil army buying the nukes need the submarine that was stolen by Stranix? Because if they did, then how do they have enough money to buy all the nukes?
I think they had like, because they had other nukes. So I just speaking from like what I know financially about how some things work, maybe they had nuke equity from the other nukes, and that
nuke
allowed
equity,
them
yeah.
to procure
yeah.
the other nukes.
That's the write-up, nuke equity.
Yeah, that was immediate write-up for me.
No, it's in there. I already read it.
Yeah,
that's the only thing I can think of. Like, these nukes are theoretically worth like this much, and then we can like use half of that on like the rest of them.
No, yeah, good point. But they're like in a council meeting, the same one that I mentioned before with the bad acting.
Yeah.
And they're like, are we sure that he disabled the North Korean submarine like we sent him to do? Or yeah. And then they show it underwater and it's supposed to signify that he stole it instead.
Yeah.
But it's full of the evil Russian people or Russian adjacent that are going to buy the nukes. And it's like, why did they need a stolen submarine?
Exactly.
So that didn't work for me. The framework for the end of this movie feels unorganized and totally dissatisfying.
It was rushed.
It was.
Yeah, I felt like they rushed it and therefore had to flesh out a few different scenarios in a very unorganized. I should have said disorganized way. You know, it just it did not seem like a coherent end.
Yeah.
To me.
That's why you voted for the celebration scene.
That is why. Yeah, we needed some real jazz.
Yeah.
All right, last one for me. Absolutely ridiculous night fight between Tommy Lee Jones and Steven Seagal.
I gotta give it to them. That I mean, like, for what this movie is, I think that what's the word I'm looking for? The choreography of that was actually pretty impressive.
To me, it looked like two kittens fighting over a catnip ball on a string.
Yeah.
Like right in the middle of them. Because they were just like pawing, you know?
Yeah. It actually.
You know what, though? I'm thinking, because Bob showed us like the awards. I know like the music won stuff, but there were nominees for the sound design. So if they sped that up and they were clanking, like someone had to wear headphones and watch that frame by frame and sync a chink noise. with each clank, and like that's fucking impressive. So I'm batting hard for this, right?
All right, last thing on that though, Rob. Maybe this will sway you. It reminded me of the Bangkok Dangerous Nicolas Cage teaching his protege montage, where again, they're just like
again,
like just yeah, again.
Yeah. Good point.
All right. Unless you guys have anything to add, let's throw it to the alternate ending.
All right.
You can do this, or you can do that, or you can do this, or you can do that, or you can do this, or you can do that. Just pick one.
Steven Seagal gains a sliver of introspection on the movie set for one half of a split fucking second and fires himself out of the torpedo chute. Erica Ilionak's tits for the remaining hour.
Nice.
I think
a couple more torpedoes, if you know what I'm saying.
Oh,
mammalian protuberances.
That's it. That's our. We got to make that our catchphrase.
Yeah.
All right. We don't need to.
Yeah.
At least
bad credit names. Bad credit names. Bad credit names.
I can't wait for this one.
Yeah? You think I got some good shit?
I think so.
I got some goodies.
Yeah, the action movies always got them.
Yes.
Bin Dang.
Okay.
Clifford Happy. He's returning.
All right.
I like Clifford Happy. I wish I knew a guy named Clifford Happy.
Yeah.
Here's one that you got to think about a little bit, but Charles Wood.
Yeah. Oh. Chuck Wood.
Yeah.
I like it.
Dale Dye.
Okay.
Oh.
Yeah. It's D-Y-E, but still it kind of blows.
Yeah.
Here's another one. Calm Meanie.
Hmm.
Calm. Those seem like opposites.
Yeah.
Calm Meanie.
Huh.
And a weird tie-in to last week, because the guy that we like the prosthetics and makeup for's name was Mean.
Yeah.
Huh.
And Dredd himself. I just called him Dredd. But Dredd himself is kind of a calm meanie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See that?
Lovelace Cook.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting first name for your daughter.
Yeah.
Yes, Lovelace, yes.
Yeah. This seems a little, like, sexy or something.
Yeah.
You know, which I wouldn't name my baby something sexy. I don't think.
The first official computer programmer was Ada Lovelace.
Huh.
Well, yeah, last name it works a little better, I think. Yeah.
Right, exactly.
Dick Hancock.
Oh,
that's
no.
The winner. Is that number one or is there something better?
Come on. Nah. That can't be real.
Dick Hancock. I felt like that would have always been my number one, but for some reason, another dick stuck out a little further for me.
Okay.
And it is Dick Zicker.
Dick Zicker. That's going in the write up.
Oh, okay. I get you on that one.
Z-I-C-K-E-R?
Z-I-K-E-R. Dick Zicker. Cool. I just really enjoyed that.
Principal McDicker. Yeah.
All right. Let's compare these movies.
Nice.
Under Siege up against Hot to Trot. We know for sure Hot to Trot won the worst because it was the worst of its kind. Under Siege was. It also got a 0% on Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah.
Just worth saying every podcast. Hopefully I remember from now on.
Yeah.
The pitch, I think, was a 4 for Hot to Trot for me.
Yeah.
And a 3.75 this week for me.
Yeah.
So that's going to give Under Siege this week's. Yes?
Yeah. And
which is good
lie.
Because I... Go ahead.
No, the numbers don't lie.
No, right. They don't. This is science. Remember, we're doing science. This is not a comedy show. It's a science show.
Yep.
The dialogue clearly was worse for Hot to Trot, in my opinion.
Yes. Compared to this, yes.
Okay, here's a little mini game before our mini game, and that is our production, what do you say to too large a cook in the kitchen versus kid marketing but adult content for Hot to Trot?
Hot to Trot wins this one, I think.
Yeah.
I think so, too.
Yeah, I never, like, I'll watch Under Siege. I always, like, when it comes down to this, I just think of which one I'd rather watch with gun to head, and I'd rather watch Under Siege. Therefore, same. Hot to Trot's worse, yeah.
Same here. I'm going to skip to acting and say that Hot to Trot is worse.
Yep.
I agree.
Yeah. Demerits Hot to Trot, 0% Rotten Tomatoes, we said already, but that brings us... We're going to play the mini game, though it is not necessary. It's 4-1.
I love the mini game.
Just because
I know where this is going, too. I'm just going to let you do it.
All right. Starting with, we're going to go Under Siege first, as is custom. Yeah. Professional kitchen target practice or blow up sex horse.
Kitchen.
Kitchen, yeah. Just
Bob wants the bonus game already.
That's a walking OSHA violation. So yeah.
All right,
come on. A horse blow up is not offensive unless you're a horse.
Yeah.
The thing is, it's definitely for furries and not for people. Or not for
that's true. Yeah.
Why can't you speak English against the samurai flower guy?
Samurai flower.
Yeah. Samurai.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, I mean, this is, you knew this, it was all going to culminate in which F word was worse. Because both of them had that particular word. And I didn't know how else to phrase it with a capital F. Which F word was worse?
I'm going to say Under Siege because. In Hot to Trot, it's just a passing, oh man, what a blank.
Mm.
But in Under Siege, in Hot to
Trot, it is guarded because they have Bobcat with Goldthwait or whatever.
Yeah.
Start speaking as Candy delivers that line. So they try to, but it's a kid's movie.
Yeah, it's a kid's movie, but in Under Siege, you're questioning someone's masculinity and saying that somebody who is not an F-slur but is a homosexual male punches like a girl.
Yeah, so
like you're kind of like but time out because I'm now remembering in Hot to Trot, he calls him the F-slur because he's a purebred, which also they're questioning the manlyhood. So I guess there goes that theory.
I
thought you were gonna be like, wait, stop, because then that's saying that girls can't punch as hard as guys.
You know what? All right. Under Siege is worse because it involves people, not horses.
Ooh.
Yeah, I'm gonna say Under Siege is worse also. For that same rationale.
All right. Well, that brings us to a 4-2 tally. So it didn't matter at all. Hot to Trot is still worst of the season.
Yep.
Hot to Trot, way to go. And now is our custom to announce what we'll be doing for the next week, which I am proud to say is Lionheart with Jean-Claude Van Damme. If you haven't seen this one, it's the fourth fighting tournament that he does. It's Bloodsport number 4, basically.
Yeah.
Okay. Only this one takes place in, like, Detroit or Cincinnati or some shit, you know?
Okay.
I'm just happy it's not Power Rangers because I never understood that shit.
Yeah,
me too, but only because kids' movies kind of suck, period.
That was not a kids' movie. It's a way of life. fun fact, look up all the Power Rangers actors in like the history of the canon of Power Rangers, every different series, and half of them are in jail for like murder.
Oh, God.
Yeah, like most of them are in jail for murder, like, with like samurai swords, too.
What?
Oh no!
What kind of drugs were they on?
Well, you know, Kimberly, the Pink Ranger, she made like what equates to $600 a week for that entire run.
Damn.
Yeah.
Oh.
They were underpaid, overworked, and then they go psychotic, basically, in real life.
Oh. I guess so.
Yeah.
It's a shame.
Fun stuff.
Well, hey, listen. Before we throw it to Bob to get his last word, before we throw it to a clip from our good friend Rob to end the show, I want to remind you that traditionally now we go live every week. If You can't join us, then head to theworstmovieevermade.com. That's got all of our links to see us on every social media you want, I think. At least it's got our YouTube, and you should check out the videos that go live every Sunday. Thank you for listening, and take it away, Bob.
I'm 45 years old. By the time this episode is released, I'll be 46.
Happy birthday.
Hey,
I did not know that about you.
Happy Sweet. House. Happy birthday.
That's a good birthday present.
Happy life.
Yeah.
Nice.
So this clip I'm playing, Bob, I know you don't like Tom Segura, but he, in his first special, he has a great bit about Steven Seagal. It's a 5-minute bit. I'm only playing the first minute 20, and we will play the show out with this.
You can learn a lot from television. For instance, without television, I would have no idea that Steven Seagal is out of his fucking mind. Or alive. I also didn't know that. He has a show. It's not a scripted show. It follows around the real Steven Seagal, and every episode begins with him looking in the camera and saying, I don't know if you knew this or not, but for the last 20 years, I've been a cop. And you're like, what did you just say? I thought you'd been making shitty movies for the last 20 years. What are you talking about? You watch the show, he has the most unlikable quality in a human being, which is that he is an expert in everything. Literally, if a dog walks by, he's like, that's a Shih Tzu boxer hound mix right there. And they're like, how do you know that? He's like, I've been working with dogs for like 35 years. Then a helicopter flies by, and he's like, that's a HUB-106. And they're like, how do you know that? And he's like, I've been flying helicopters for like 47 years. Then he does the thing, though, that everybody does who knows something about everything. Everybody has a friend, no matter what you're doing. They know the history of it all. They know every topic, every fucking fact. If you're eating dinner, they're like, you know, forks are from the Roman times, and they would sculpt them out of bark. And you're like, will you shut the fuck up and let me finish this, please? Seagal will do that, too, but you know he's making it up. He'll be like, you know, they also call that helicopter a Skippy. And they're like, why? He goes, listen to it. Skip, 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 skip. That's bullshit.
All right, see you guys.